perspective. Of all their notions about cosmic truths, this expression is the only true one. And indeed, each of them is the image of God, not of that God they picture with their bobtailed reason, but of the real God that we sometimes call our common megalocosmos. Each of them, down to the smallest detail, is exactly similar, though in miniature, to the whole of our megalocosmos, and in each of them there are all the separate functionings which actualize in the megalocosmos the cosmic harmonious Iranira New Age, or exchange of substances, maintaining the existence of everything existing as one whole. Of theirs, we are made in the image of God, can serve as here as a very good illustration of how far the main logic, or, as it is sometimes called, aimlessly meditation, has already passed for them. Although this formulation corresponds, when they try to express its exact meaning, it is the same reasons in general with all their formulations that are perfected highest bodies of free brain beings who have already united themselves with the most holy sun absolute or protocosmos. When these highest parts of free-brain beings are perfected to the corresponding radiation of objective reason, attain this union, they fulfill precisely that function of creation of the now existing world, when he graciously decided to...
The brain, which is the body's memory, is the body's memory. I'm going to go to the hospital. Intentional non-violent, Thank you. Right. Thank you. Well, that's the point of the world's creation, which I'm going to I'm going to go to the next one. We're going to be able to do that. We're going to be able to do that. Finally coordinate with them. Began to be
transformed and crystallized within a sacred neo-archelopoeus, thus participating in the coding of the highest parts of these beings. And from that time on, these sacred arisings contain special properties in their presences, due to the fact that certain manifestations of the other parts of the being in these sacred arisings were being coded assimilated in the composition of these higher parts, producing very unusual results which came to be called, and are called even now, sins of the body and the soul. It was just on account of those unusual results that these cosmic formations, even if perfected to the required gradation of objective reason, ceased to correspond in their common presences to the conditions of existence in the sphere of the most holy protocosmos, and from then on lost the possibility of being meaningfully to unite themselves with it. Well then, as soon as the facts became known about the helpless position of these highest being bodies who had become independent cosmic sacred individuals, perfected in reason, but whose presences no longer correspond to the most holy Sun Absolute, our all-loving Creator, in His infinite justice and mercy, at once took all the corresponding measures demanded by this unforeseen and sorrowful phenomenon. This grievous phenomenon indeed placed these sacred individuals in a desperate situation because they had no possibility, on account of those sins in their presences, of uniting with the bosom of the prime source of the great whole, yet at the same time, having attained that gradation of the sacred scale of reason which subjects them to the second order cosmic law named Tenexander, they have lost the possibility of free existence on the surface of ordinary planets. Among the various divine measures undertaken was the issuance of this decree to choose the very best planet in the whole of our great megalocosmos, to adapt its surface in a special manner, and to reserve it for the further free existence of these highest being bodies that were perfected in reason, so that they might have all the possibilities of purifying themselves from the undesirable elements in their presences. It was then that for the first time this holy planet was seen to be observatory, and its chief organization and government were undertaken at its own risk by our all-quarters maintainer, the great arch-sheriff Halcomanios, that same great Halcomanios who after the creation of the world first merited the sacred anklet, that is, first attained that degree of reason which is the highest that can be attained by an independent individual, whatever his nature, and which is the third degree below the absolute reason of our endlessness. The world of this holy planet is indeed the very best in every respect, as you have seen for yourself, and everything on its surface is of such a quality that it is always perceived, as I have already said, exclusively, in other words, blissfully, delightfully, by each independent individual, yet for these perfected highest being bodies who exist there, this is of no account, since they are always deeply absorbed in their intense work of purifying themselves from those undesirable elements which have entered their presences for reasons totally foreign to their individuality. In the common presences of these unfortunate highest being bodies, perfected in reason to the highest limit attainable by ordinary higher cosmic individuals, there is one single atom which occasionally engenders in them the impulse of hope that they may at some time purify themselves, and have the happiness of uniting shining with and becoming a part of that greatness which are all just common bother endlessly satisfies us with the fear and happiness of everything existing in our microcosmos. Here it is interesting to note that almost all the three-brained beings arising on the various planets of our macrocosmos either know or instinctively sense the existence of the holy planet Earth or not. It is only the three-brained beings on the planet who remain unaware of it, or at least the majority of those who arose shortly before the loss of the continent of Atlantis and its disappearance. And for the realization of these dreams of layers, those three-brained beings who have attained a greater self-awareness always eagerly and even joyfully accept those unpleasantnesses to their presence coming from privations suffered by their planetary bodies during their ordinary being existence. They will understand and instinctively feel that their lower being body is, in their own sacred cosmic law of Freemasonom now, the indispensable source of denying manifestations of all kinds, and as such must always manifest itself negatively toward their affirming part. In other words, the manifestations of this lower part of theirs must necessarily always be opposed to what is required by their highest being part. Thus every wish of the planetary body is taken as undesirable for the highest divine part that has to be corrected, and that is why all the three center beings of our great macrocosmos constantly carry on a relentless struggle against the desires of their planetary bodies. So the truth is, this particularly affliction, as it is called, the sacred crystallization which is formed is for the rising and perfecting of this highest divine being part. In this constant struggle of theirs, the equilibrating, harmonizing principle is their second being body, which, in their own individual law of Freemasonom, represents the neutralizing source, and therefore the second being part always remains indifferent to their mechanical manifestations, but during their active manifestations it always tends, in accordance with the second order cosmic law of Freemasonom, to unite with those desires of which it is born, either in one or the other of the two opposite being parts. As I have already said in the beginning, that is, before the loss of the continent of Atlantis, the three-brained beings of the planet also had an approximate understanding of the holy planet Purgatory, and there even existed several legomenisms about it after the loss of that continent. Certain fragments of these legomenisms were preserved intact by learned beings at that time who happened to survive, and these fragments began to be transmitted from generation to generation. Later, when that peculiar disease of theirs, which I characterized by the word wise acrim, arose in the psyche of these strange three-brained beings, they began to wiseacre with this fragmentary information about the holy planet Purgatory in such a way that, in the psyche of beings of subsequent generations, representations and conceptions began to be formed in depicts which are defined to perfection by a certain incomparable Mullah Nasruddin, consisting of the following being sound, short sword,
Such embellishments as art. Imitation, which by that time had become inherent in these terrestrial free brain In order to increase this fat in their planetary bodies, and this form of being On the contrary, he's abstaining once he comes, as is usually said there, then as a rail, and the penetrating action of the poisoning of the rail vibrations is evident chiefly in their general psychics, which come sharply dual, manifestations of two diametrically opposite lines, the outer invisible, for show, sensed by everyone around them, and the inner and hidden, ordinary beings there, especially the contemporary ones, are entirely incapable of perceiving or detecting in other words, in their outer, visible manifestations, these poisoning Osirian monks appear to be what your favorites would describe as bigots of the highest degree, and in their secret inner manifestations, hidden from others, what your favorites would call expert cynics, also of the highest rank. As for why the involutionary process of the exoherry, the monks are in the abstaining monks' faces, associated Osirian vibrations, instead of deposits of fat, there even exists a very detailed theory, worked out several centuries ago by certain ones called conclusively that this happens because in the first years of their existence these thin monks busy themselves very zealously with that occupation from which, as is known even to contemporary medicine, pimples generally appear on the faces of young beings there. Absolutely represent to yourself and fully understand the significance of this sort of abstinence among these contemporary monks, it remains for me to add that during my last sojourn on the planet Earth I became convinced that, thanks only to the results of the involutionary process of the exoherry in these unfortunate terrestrial abstaining monks, the crystallization of various consequences of the properties of the organ cundibuffer in their common presence has become greatly facilitated and has therefore increased. Beelzebub was interrupted by a ship's servant who handed him a Lady Jambrose. He put it to his ear and began to listen to the contents. Chapter 40. Beelzebub tells how men learned and again forgot about the fundamental cosmic law of Heptapara Parshino. After Beelzebub had listened to the contents of the Lady Jambrose handed to him, his grandson Hassing again turned to him and said, "Dear and kind grandfather, please help me clear up one contradiction which I do not understand and which does not accord with my logical confrontations." When you began your elucidations concerning the holy planet Purgatory, you enjoined me to try to take in everything you told me, without missing anything, and you also enjoined me to maintain without ceasing the intensity of my active mentation, so the corresponding data for a clear representation of all these ancient books, fundamental sacred cosmic laws should be completely crystallized in me. I did indeed try during all your elucidations to do so, and it seems to me, I cleared up so much for myself about these cosmic laws that perhaps I could even freely explain them to someone else. In any case, I can already represent to myself very well the sacred law of Triamasicondo, the particularities of all three of its independent sacred forces, and have cognized it for my own essence quite satisfactorily. And in regard to the sacred law of Heptapara Parshino, although certain of its details, unimportant in my opinion, are still not entirely clear to my reason. I hope that with a little more active pondering I shall understand them as well. However, while trying to assimilate these sacred laws thoroughly, I clearly sense that they are very complicated and that it is difficult to have a complete understanding of them. Then suddenly a question comes in me which begins to perplex and interest me. How is it possible that the three-brained beings who arise and exist on the planet Earth would understand these sacred cosmic laws, or could even discern them among the surrounding cosmic results? From all your tales about these beings, I got the full impression that ever since the second Transapalmian perturbation there, each of them, by the time he reaches responsible age, thanks to the prevailing abnormal Bastiano, possesses only automatic reason. And when I myself tried to understand these two sacred cosmic laws, I became convinced with the whole of my essence that it would be impossible to do so with that reason alone. Having said this, Gassing looked inquiringly and eagerly at his beloved grandfather. Beelzebub, after thinking a moment, began to speak as follows. All right, my dear boy, I shall try to throw some light on this natural complexity which understandably arises within you. It seems to me that I already know that ever since the period you mentioned, almost all the three-brained beings on that planet, thanks to the abnormally established conditions of ordinary being existence, have had only an automatic reason. Nevertheless, it does sometimes happen that certain of them chance to escape this common fate and, instead of that original automatic reason, genuine objective being reason is formed in them as it is in all three center beings of our great megalocosmos. Such exceptions, especially during recent centuries, are very rare there, yet, I repeat, they do occur. In order that you may approximately represent to yourself and understand how these exceptions occur, you must above all remember that, although apt with the consequences. The properties of the Orin Thunderbird had begun to be crystallized in the very reason became quite automatic. Nevertheless, the presence each one of them has always contained, from their arising in the beginning of their formation, the germ of all the possibilities for the crystallization, during their further formation into responsible beings, of corresponding being categories to later serve for the engendering and functioning of objective reason, that reason which should be in the common presence of three-brained beings of all natures and all external forms, and is none other than the representative of the very essence of divinity. Their greatest misfortune in the objective sense, which you yourself instinctively suspect, as I discern from the way you ask this question, especially from your allusion to Bastiano, is that, in spite of having such possibilities in themselves and their arising, they are subjected from the very first days after separation from their mother's womb, thanks to the abnormalities established in the process of ordinary being existence of the beings of responsible age around them, to the stubborn influence of that specific means they have invented for their own use, namely, that sort of Bastiano, I have already told you about, called education. In consequence, the possibilities for the free development of all that is required for engendering objective being reason are gradually atrophied in these unfortunate, literally blameless, moving through seeings, and finally disappear during the period of their preparatory age, and responsible age, they acquire in the center of gravity of their essence, instead of the objective reason they ought to have, merely a strange conglomeration of automatically received artificial and even deceptive impressions which, though having nothing in common with the organizations of their spiritualized being parts, never. Less makes a connection with the separate functioning of their common presence as a result. Not only does the whole process of their existence flow automatically, but almost the entire process of the functioning of their planetary body becomes dependent only on accidental, external impressions, also perceived automatically. In very rare cases, certain of these favorites of the Force, on reaching responsible age, possess genuine pure reason, proper to responsible free-range beings. This usually comes about in the following way. For instance, one of these newly arisen beings, immediately after separation from his mother's womb, finds himself in the course of his further formation in surrounding conditions in which all those abnormalities have built to overflow the entire process of external being existence of the three brain beings breathing on this elevated planet do not touch him or have any maleficent influence over him, and thus the germ within him of the possibility of acquiring pure reason does not have time during the process of his further formation to atrophy to the very root. Furthermore, it also sometimes happens that in these relatively normal conditions, such a young three-brained being, during the period of his preparation for responsible existence, finds a responsible guide of three-brained being, also of course by chance, is completely formed in the same way, and in the functioning of his waking consciousness there already participates, thanks to the frequent fulfillment in his presence of being part while retaining the data which have remained whole in his subconscious for engendering the divine impulse of consciousness. And so this same guide, who is aware with the whole of his being of the importance and significance of the responsibility taken upon himself in relation to the new being who has only just reached preparatory age to the aforementioned conditions, begins, impartially and according to Khan, to create for his, Bossiano, every kind of inner and outer factor for perceiving corresponding impressions, in order to crystallize in his common presence all those data which alone, in their totality, can give to the three-brained being when he reaches responsible age the power, celestial, or, as your favorites would say, the power not to be identified with and not to be affected by externals but one's inevitably inherent passions, and it is solely this being impulse, engendered in the being by these data, that can help him to attain a free and impartial observation of all three phenomena appearing in the cosmic results around him. Here it is appropriate to remark that on most planets of our megalocosmos where three-brained beings arise and exist, there is an often repeated saying formulated in the following words. Our common father endlessness is only the creator of a three-centered being with the genuine creator of his essence during the period of his preparatory existence is his, O-S-K-I-A-N-O-T-S-N-E-R, that is, he whom your favorites on the planet Earth call, educator, single quote. And so it sometimes happens, many centuries that one of your favorites who has reached responsible age has been completely formed and prepared for external perceptions in the way I described, discovers by chance a certain non-conformable particularity in the cosmic results around him and begins to study it in detail and from every aspect, and having ultimately, after long persevering labors, attained to some objective truth, he initiates similar beings around him into this truth. Now, my boy, listen while I tell you how these peculiar three-brained beings first became aware of the fundamental cosmic law of the sacred heptagon of Harshino, and how the totality of information concerning this knowledge possessed by certain beings of ancient times was actualized in all its details from generation to generation, thus becoming the inheritance of every subsequent three-brained being of this planet of yours, and listen also to what the strangeness of their psyche has made out of all this. I wish to explain to you in as great detail as possible, in historical sequence, not only how your favorites became aware of this sacred law, but also how they gradually forgot about it. This information would greatly help you to elucidate those unimportant details, as you call them, which you have not yet completely transubstantiated in your reason furthermore. Learn from this that even in our day, among your contemporary favorites, genuinely learned responsible beings who occasionally appear to some partial and modest conscious efforts to generate the arising and gradual development of genuine objective science even on this ill-fated planet, assuming that the other three-brained beings were to exist more or less normally, and as a result that welfare might also be obtained for them which has long since been merited and enjoyed by the three-brained beings of all other planets of our great megacosmos. In the beginning, during the period when the three-brained beings of that planet still had in themselves the organ conductor, it was of course out of the question that they could have learned about any cosmic force. But later, when this maleficent organ had been removed from their presence, and when in consequence their psyche became created, so to speak, individual, and their own, it was just then that all the trouble arose with their relatively sane pigmentation. The first time that these three-brained beings who have taken your fancy perceived and cognized with their full presence the fundamental cosmic law of the sacred heptagon of Harshino was on the continent of Atlantis when C.E.R. Join beings, can you remember, I have already told you, understood by themselves that something, not quite right, proceeded in them, and when they also discovered that they had certain possibilities of destroying this something, not quite right, and of becoming such as they ought to be. It was just at that period of flow of time when certain of them had observed those abnormal functionings, proceeding in their common presence, abnormal, that is, according to sane being mentation, and were seeking out their causes, and trying to find every possible means of removing them from themselves, that many branches of genuine science reached a very high degree of development among those who were seriously interested in this most essential activity of reason, as it was then called, was a terrestrial three-brained being by the name of Theophany, who was the first to lay a rational foundation for the subsequent development of this branch of genuine science. As I chanced to learn later, this Theophany was once pouring a certain mixture on arms slapped to dry, which consisted of the extract of the plant then falls, which they took, pine resin, and sleep from the melt of the then pavement, pinion and goats, so that when hardened and released, the mastic used for chewing after eating, when he noticed for the first time that in whatever way and in whatever quantity this mixture was poured onto the marble slab, it always solidified in the same way, and after the final cooling always assumed a form composed of seven distinct plane surfaces. This fact, unexpectedly ascertained by Theophany, greatly astonished him, and an intense wish arose in his heart and breast, elucidate from his reason the root causes, still unknown to him, of this lock-informable phenomenon, and he therefore began to repeat the same procedure, now to the conscious aim. From the very beginning of the investigations on this, taken by Theophany, his friends, other learned beings with whom he shared the findings of his experiments, also became interested and participated in his further research. Well then, after long and detailed investigations, this group of learned three-brained beings of your planet recognized for the first time and became categorically convinced that almost all the cosmic results manifested around them were perceived by the ordinary beings in some or other definite form, always having the course of their external transitory state seven independent aspects. As the result of the conscious labors of these learned three-brained beings, a branch of almost normal science arose and began to develop on the continent of Atlantis under the name of Tassilorinono, which meant the science of the seven aspects of every whole phenomenon. But when that continent perished, no trace of this branch of genuine science survived, and again for many long centuries the beings of that planet knew nothing about this sacred cosmic law. This branch of science on the continent of Atlantis was evidently so widely known that the learned beings there saw no need to include anything about it in a legomenism. When they remember, they usually remember all those ideas, the knowledge of which they wish to transmit unchanged to beings of future generations. As the legomenism concerning this branch of science had existed, something of this knowledge would certainly have been preserved, as was the case with other knowledge attained by the beings of Atlantis, through those who were by chance saved after the loss of that continent. Knowledge concerning this sacred hexaparagine of became known again only after many of their centuries, thanks to two great terrestrial learned beings, the brothers Chumbotes and Chumbotel, who later became saints and who are now on the holy planet Purgatory where we have just been. Do you remember, I already told you that on the continent of Asia, the country where Elsa Caesar was a king named Coniagin, a descendant of the learned member of the Society of Octans who had gone there from Atlantis for the observation of all kinds of natural phenomena of their planet, and that this same king had invented for his subjects the ingenious tale I told you about in order to save them from the pernicious habit of chewing the seeds of the flower called Novulian. Well then, the grandson of this king Coniagin, after the arising of an heir who in his turn became king over the beings of this group, had two results of the male sex, twins. The first of whom was named Chum Kiltes and the second Chum Tropel, and
Planetary and intraplanetary formations in general, and particularly
among formations called aura. There arise, for the purposes of the transformation of common cosmic substances in the process of the modern age, three classes of crystallizations. With crystallizations belonging to the first class are called frequency analyzings. Those belonging to the second class, Kastronian arisings, and those belonging to the third class, Kalorniak arisings. Through this, Kastronian arisings, there are transformed in the course of evolutionary or evolutionary processes those cosmic crystallizations or active elements, which are derived only from substances transformed by that planet itself on which this kind of superplanetary or intraplanetary formation exists for the purposes of the common cosmic or aura. Of Kastronian arisings, there are transformed, besides the cosmic crystallizations I have mentioned, also those active elements which are derived from the substances transformed by the sun itself and by the other planets of the given solar system. And through the arisings of the third class, namely the Kalorniak, there are transformed, besides the cosmic crystallizations in the first two classes, all those active elements coming from the transformation of substances of various cosmic concentrations belonging to other solar systems of our common megalocosmos. This planetary formation known on your planet by the name of Poppy belongs to the class of Kalorniak arisings, and further evolves or involves the totality of the results of the transformation of all other cosmic centers of gravity concentrations penetrating the atmosphere of this planet and works through the common cosmic process of what is called the universal diffusion of the radiations of all kinds of cosmic concentrations. And so, my boy, that's for these great terrestrial learned beings, which at this point in Chintropel, were more or less settled in their new place of permanent existence in that still quite young China. They resume the intentional fulfillment interrupted through no fault of theirs, the same part all duty in the professional field chosen for their responsible existence, namely, scientific research in the branch called medicine. Single quote. They then undertook a study of the totality of cosmic substances which their favorites had long since learned to extract from that Kalorniak planet of bad names, Helium, a word denoting in the language of the beings of that group, Dreammaker. Single quote. These two great brothers began to investigate this Helium because they, as well as many other free-brained beings at that time, noticed that on introducing a certain preparation of this substance into themselves, every painful sensation temporarily disappeared. First of all, they set out to study the action of all its properties and of only finding one property by means of which to eradicate or at least bring under control the special form of psychic illness, which was then very widespread among the communities around them. In the course of their research, they first noticed that this opium consisted of seven independent crystallizations with specific subjective properties. And on further and more detailed investigations, they established clearly that each of the seven independent crystallizations of this one whole consisted in its turn of seven other specific crystallizations, also with their independent subjective properties, and these in their turn, again of seven, and so on almost to infinity. feeling so grateful that they put aside all the tasks they had set themselves, and from then on devoting themselves with perseverance exclusively to the investigation of this amazing fact which they had been the first to observe, and ultimately they attained results without precedent, even at the very end of the existence of the continent of Atlantis, and unequal at any later epoch among the three great beings of your planet. Well, many centuries after the planetary existence of these great terrestrial Earth beings, now saints, Chun Kiltes and Chun Kobel, when I happened, for one of my investigations, to become acquainted with the detailed history of their activities, I learned that, after they had been convinced beyond doubt that this totality of cosmic substances called opium consists of a whole range of compounds of seven active elements with different subjective properties, they began, with the same aim, to investigate many other cosmic results or, as it said there, phenomena occurring in their environment. Later, however, they confined their investigations only to three, namely to opium, to what is called the white ray, and to smell. A single quote. While studying those three diversely manifested cosmic processes, they became categorically convinced that although these three results in respect of their origin and outer manifestations have nothing in common, their inner structure and functioning are exactly alike down to the smallest detail. In short, for the second time on your planet, and long after the loss of the continent of Atlantis, these twin brothers verified and categorically demonstrated again that every separate and independent phenomenon, if each is taken as a unit, consists in the totality of its manifestations of seven secondary independent units, each with its own subjective properties, that these secondary independent units in their turn consist of seven tertiary units, and so on almost to infinity, and that in each of these primary, secondary, and tertiary units, and so on, the processes of reciprocal relation and reciprocal influence take place in the same way, with rigorous exactitude, down to the smallest detail, and with similar consequences. By the way, my boy, in the course of their investigations, they differentiated and defined for the first time the seven independent aspects of each whole phenomenon, as well as its secondary and tertiary derivatives. They named the first seven fundamental aspects of each whole. 1ERTIPKINON, 2ORIPKINON, 3SAMBIPKINON, 4OTPKINON, 5OTPKINON, 6FCPKINON, 7SHIPKINON. And the second order aspects. 1ERTI NORICHAKA, 2ORI NORICHAKA, 3SAMBI NORICHAKU, 4OT NORICHAKA, 5OT NORICHAKA, 6FC NORICHAKA, 7SHBIDI NORICHAKU. And in order to indicate which of the three results of cosmic processes each of these names referred to, they added after each one the following, for indicating the nuances of sound, after noting the number of their vibrations, they always added to the name the word, a lil. Single quote. For indicating the particularities of the composition of the white ray, they added the expression, Narkron Aura. And for indicating the active elements of the Palorn Dectic product called
Indispensable for their own existence. I shall describe it to you in some detail.
All on top of the rich banks of Bornholm artwork became famous among the genuine scientists of almost the whole megalocosmos, came about as a result of the following chance circumstances. During one of my sojourns on the planet Saturn, I asked his friend Bornholm Arhart, Our contemporary favorites, However, imagine that the color erasing get from this child's toilet cola. The results were the same. Positive rays, which the great scientists obtained, and in their naivety they think that the spectrum, as they call it, derived from the white rays is the same order of appearance as the rays as that in which they issue from their source. In short, as regards these sorry scientists of new formation, one could only utter the expression often used by your favorites themselves, to hell with them. It is not for nothing that certain of our sacred individuals have no other word for their contemporary favorites than freaks. And so, with the aid of these two crystals, those great learned beings obtained from the white ray its positive colored rays and then, by means of the slab, polished mortar, which was the heart of the Calypso Chicana, any one of these colored rays was directed onto the turret. This principal part consisted of an ordinary tripod, on the top of which two balls, also of ivory, were fitted one upon the other in a certain way, the upper ball being much larger than the lower one. The smaller ball, directly opposite the part of the Calypso Chicana that already passed, the cavity of a special form in which was placed under the horn-decked chronic name, opium, one of its active elements required for the experiment. The upper ball was bored right along its diameter horizontally, at right angles to the Calypso Chicana, and another, smaller floor was drilled into the same ball, radially perpendicular to the larger floor, but reaching only to the center and directly opposite the Calypso Chicana. This second bore, drilled halfway through, was made in such a way that the colored rays could be projected as desired either directly from the Calypso Chicana or reflected from the cavity of the lower, smaller ball. Through the open bore in the larger ball, we would be freely moved what is called a and contained, previously prepared in a second manner. A long time before the experiment, numbers of these bamboo canes were soaked together in conditions of absolute darkness, or in orange light, as is said there on the earth, obtained from burning, scintillage, obtained from a certain kind of clay, usually deposited in the soil of your planet near accumulations of salumilobian acids, which in their turn were formed from masmalin ore, as your favorites call it, naphtha. These bamboo canes were soaked in a liquid consisting of one whites of eggs from the bird called Amyrsa marcinara, to the juice of a plant called Chilterpex, or the excretion of a quadruped being bearing the name of Kesmarl, or a specially prepared amalgam of mercury. When these bamboo canes had been thoroughly soaked, they were inserted one by one into the other bamboo canes not prepared in this manner, the ends of which were hermetically sealed. These latter preparations were of course also made in absolute darkness, or in the orange light of Later, when one of these soaked bamboo canes was required for an experiment, one end of the thicker, unsoaked cane was inserted in a special way into the bore which was drilled right. The
planetary bodies of these mammoths have never been exposed to decomposition, as it's said there. In other words, the active elements of which these planetary bodies
bodies are composed of nothing but we evolved back to their divine origin. And so, my boy, this astonishing apparatus, Paula Toppin, demonstrated that all three transitory results of cosmic processing I have just been speaking of not only are like the narrative manifestations, but are also made up of the same factors. By means of this apparatus, it was possible to verify and demonstrate that in each of the three transitory results of common cosmic processes having outwardly nothing in common, exactly the same reciprocal actions take place, ensuing each from the other to constitute one common functioning, and that it requires the evolutionary and involutionary properties of the law of Heptaparamarshina, the action at any separate intermediate stage in the total functioning of one of these results influences the action at each separate intermediate stage in another, exactly as in its own functioning, and furthermore that with respect to the properties of the vibrations of which they are constant with, these transitory cosmic results have complete affinity. This complete affinity in the inner reciprocal relations of these three transitory results which have outwardly nothing in common is proven in the following way. For example, a colored ray directed upon an active element of opium transformed it into another active element corresponding in its newly acquired vibrations to those of the colored ray which had acted upon it. And then, instead of the colored ray, corresponding vibrations of sound from the strings of the zendo were directed upon this same active element, the same result was obtained. Further, if any colored ray was made to pass through any active element of opium or sin, in passing through it, this same ray took on another color, namely, that color whose vibrations corresponded to those of this active element, or if any colored ray was made to pass through the wave of sound vibrations still resounding at that moment from any corresponding string of the zenfo, then, in passing through this wave, it took on another color, corresponding to the vibrations produced by the given string. Finally, if a specific colored ray and specific sound vibrations were simultaneously directed upon any active element of opium from among those having a lower number of vibrations than the sum of the vibrations of the colored ray and of the sound, then this active element of opium was transformed into another, the number of whose vibrations corresponded exactly to the sum of the two differently caused vibrations, and so on and so forth. This incomparable experimental apparatus likewise demonstrated that the higher vibrations of one result always give the direction to the lower vibrations of other transitory cosmic results. After all you have just been told, my boy, you can now be given the information thanks to which there might be crystallized in your mentation data for understanding what sort of results proceeded from the tenacious and impartial conscious labors of these saintly twin brothers, the great terrestrial scientists, and also for understanding the extent to which the being reason in the presence of their unfortunate favorites has progressively deteriorated. And so, for the second time in the course of my observations of the existence of these three brain beings who have taken your fancy, there arose in this still quite young China, thanks to the twin brothers, those great terrestrial scientists, an independent branch of genuine science, that is, some of the information concerning a special question, thoroughly cognized by the perfected the reason of three brain beings of earlier ethics in the given case. And this happened chiefly because they maintained the practice, established by the learned beings of the continent of Atlantis, of handing down such information to beings of subsequent generations only their genuine initiates. Here, my lord, I cannot fail to remark and declare with conviction that indeed, if this long-established practice had been maintained, even automatically, in the process of existence of these unfortunate three-brain beings who have taken your fancy, this sum of true information, already thoroughly assimilated by the race of their still, relatively normal, ancestors, might have remained intact and might have become the inheritance of your contemporary favorites, and moreover, those of them who constantly strive not to become complete victims of the consequences of the organ cunt buffer, a person for them, might have taken advantage of this information with the aim of easing their now almost impossible inner struggle. But to the regret of all more or less conscious, relatively independent individuals of our great megalocosmos, and to the misfortune of all the three-brain beings arising on this located planet of yours, after two or three of their centuries of blessing created for them by their great ancestors, thanks to their conscious labor and intentional suffering, gradually began to be distorted and was ultimately almost totally destroyed. This followed from two causes. The first was that, owing to the same abnormal conditions of the strange being existence they themselves established, certain of them became responsible beings for that special psycho-organic being, which in their speech might be formulated thus, an irresistible force to be considered learned by beings around them like themselves. And this psycho-organic being began to engender in them the strange tendency I have spoken about many times, which they call cunning wise acting. Single quote. Bear in mind once and for all that whenever I use the expression, learned beings of new formation, I refer to those of your favorites who are afflicted with this special inheritance. The other cause was that owing to certain external circumstances of that period not depending on them, but ensuing from common cosmic processes, chiefly from the action of the law of Sodio and Theus, the being data crystallized in them for engendering the impulses of sensitivity and foresight, weakened in the common presence of the genuine initiated beings, and they began to accept into their midst these types of new formation, and to initiate them into certain true information, the totality of which was known to them alone from that time on. This branch of genuine knowledge, becoming the possession of so many, began gradually to be distorted and once again was almost entirely forgotten. I use the word almost with respect because when a relatively normal process of being existence had been re-established, certain fragments of the totality of this objectively approached it through inspiration again began to be handed down exclusively through genuine initiates and passing down unchanged from one generation to another, which within your contemporary favorites will only a very limited number of them. Most of your contemporary favorites, however, received from all this true knowledge, attained and thoroughly cognized by their great and remote ancestors, which you cracked. Single fragments of little importance that have reached them automatically, and which in the troubled period I mentioned were very widespread among the ordinary beings of this little white young China. Among these unimportant fragments that automatically reached most of your contemporary favorites are, first, several methods of extracting from the polarmectic product named opium, certain of its independent active elements, second, what is called a solid combination of colors, and third, the 7-tone scale of sound. Single quote. As regards the first of the three fragments relating to the practical results attained by the reason of three great beings of ancient China, I must tell you that since certain of the components of this product called opium have special properties exerting an agreeable action on the abnormal common psyche of beings, it came into constant use, and therefore the knowledge of many methods of extracting certain of its independent active elements began to be transmitted from generation to generation and reached your contemporary favorites. At the present time, they extract many of its specific elements and use them aptly for the satisfaction of always the same consequences of the properties of the organ Kundabuffer crystallized in them. These elements, extracted by them from the general composition of this polarmectic product, have other names, of course, among your contemporary favorites. One of their comic-worn chemists, asserting mentally that he has collected the names of all those active elements now available, so to say, classified them according to their atomic weights. Although his classification does not correspond at all to reality, it is possible, according to these atomic weights, to approximate the classification established by those great terrestrial worm beings of China. Of the nearly 400 active elements of opium that became known to the Great Brothers, the contemporary chemists of the Earth know how to obtain only 48, which now have the following names: 1-morphine, 2-protopine, 3-lanthopine, 4-chloroquine, opium, 1-narcotine, 6-paramorphine, 3-main, 7-formine, 6-morphine, 8-metamorphine, 9-mucosine, 11-atropine, 12-pyrodine, 13-riodine, 14-tictudine, collagen, 16-xanthaline, 17-sudine, 18-tributine, 19-modine, lodocine, 21-protoferine, 22-arcotocine, 23-cocidocine, 24-cinocine, meconidine, 26-papaverine, 27-cryptonine, 28-cadmonine, 29-polymonine, coilonidine, 31-cotarmine, 32-hydrocotarmine, 33-opionine or retinine, 34-mecotriocene, 35-listerine, 36-actinocene, 37-codeine, 38-narcine, 39-pseudocodine, 40-microparine, 41-R-nitrocaine, 42-methane. The last time I was on your planet, I heard that the contemporary learned beings of the community of Germany had, as it were, discovered methods of extracting several other independent active elements I do no interest in these scientific attainments.